Now, I think most people will acknowledge that the prison system is racist, and even the most liberal among this group will acknowledge, if not racist, well, then the prison system is racially biased. What few will acknowledge is that toppling the prison system will require much more than a racial justice, or in liberal language, a new civil rights movement. And let me put this in perspective for you. George Jackson, who is arguably one of the most famous political prisoners, whose murder in 1971 sparked the Attica Rebellion, said in his book, Blood in My Eye, racism enters on the psychosocial level in the form of a morbid fear of both blacks and revolutions. That's something that's really not acknowledged by so-called activists or social rights advocates, because that language of the revolution has been stripped from most of the prison justice movement. Many people who talk about civil liberties forget that the roots of this civil rights movement, which is a language that's comfortable for mostly whites and liberals when they're talking about these black and brown demonic figures outside their window, people forget that the movement that gave birth to this was actually the Black Power movement. The decolonization movements of the Third World as they were throwing off their colonialist chains. And these movements were explicitly and always and uncompromisingly revolutionary. I think in this context, we have to realize that there are two types of prisoners only. And this is a thought that has been furthered by people like Huey P. Newton and Maroon himself. There's first the illegitimate capitalist, who is someone who seeks to acquire what the capitalist system has deemed legitimate by means that those in power have said are illegitimate. So I can give you an example. A young poor woman who steals a designer sweatshirt from a store is labeled a criminal, whereas the owner of that shop, whose store is built on stolen land, or the factory owner who made that sweatshirt using slave labor, is not considered a criminal. So this is the illegitimacy of crime. The second kind of prisoner or criminal is someone who refuses to participate in this system, either legitimately or illegitimately, and believes that this system has to be overthrown. These are the political prisoners, and this is what Maroon is. And I think in a country that has instilled a morbid fear of the word revolution by equating it with the failures, so-called, of the Soviet Union and Communist China, that we need to really think about how and why this word of revolution is not just something from the past, but is very much alive in political prisoners like Maroon today, and why we need to not be afraid to use that word, and why it can mean many different things. For example, this hardened political Black Panther revolutionary that Maroon has been posited at for most of his time in prison, how did he come to be a revolutionary? I think a good example is going to be the first chapter of the new autobiography, which Fred Ho and I are working on. And that chapter is going to be called Negro Ice Cream Cones, after Maroon's own title, and this is why. When he was, I think it was maybe 7 or 8, his sister Saida is here, she can remind me. Was he 7 at the time that this happened? So this was probably his first act of, you can call it community organizing. Maroon lived in a neighborhood in Philadelphia where a local grocer was selling ice cream cones for $1.50, right? $1.50, $1. And he decided that the grocer was a white man, and it was a majority black neighborhood. And Maroon noticed that the black grocery store owner a couple of blocks away was not making as many sales because he had to charge $2 for the ice cream cone because he was not able to buy in bulk the way that the white grocer was. And at the age of 7, he organized a boycott of the white grocery store and encouraged his peers and his family members to shop locally at the black grocery store and buy their ice cream cones for a little bit more. So this is what revolution means. He wasn't participating in the system, he wanted to overturn it, he wanted to give back to the community the rights that were officially theirs. And for these reasons and others, he's been held for more than 30 years. I'm sure his name also, maybe of you know this, but some of you don't. Maroon is another word that strikes fear into the heart of the jailers, because for them it's unknown. In reality, he took his name from the legendary communities that ran away from the slave plantations, first in Suriname, Jamaica, Haiti, and later Brazil, and various other colonies, and took shelter in the mountains and the forests around the slave plantations and refused to be enslaved. They were marooned. They were literally cut off completely from the system that they were refusing to participate in. After his second liberation attempt, he became known as Maroon because he was not going to sit around and wait patiently for liberation to be bought by means that the state had considered just. The fact that he survived for 27 days a slave hunt after his first liberation attempt, wherein the entire weight of the prison system, of the National Guard with helicopters and sniffer dogs and local extremely bloodthirsty skinheads were out searching for him, and that he evaded them alone out there for 27 days is absolutely nothing short of heroic. And this is something that neither he nor anyone else should be afraid to say is a revolutionary act and is an act that needs huge replication across the board. Maroon wrote to me recently about SCI Green, which is the torture chamber, or the hole, if you like to call it that, that he's been in for the last 20 years. He wrote, "The torture technicians who developed a paradigm used at the control housing units that I'm in realized that they had to separate those with leadership qualities, but also break those individuals' minds and bodies and keep them separated until they are dead. And I don't think we're going to let that happen to him." Thank you.